Hello and welcome to This Is. Austin, why are you an Apple fanboy?
Because clearly Apple products are the best things that I can possibly imagine. Matt, you can't see me right now, but I'm holding up my Microsoft Surface Go 2, the superior choice for this particular video. So we have a very thorough tier list of pretty much every single Apple product and service. So let's go through, starting with the MacBook Air. I actually think for the first time since like 2013, 2014, the MacBook Air is not only a solid laptop, but I think a really easy recommendation. We did a video on it on the main channel where essentially they fixed all of the major issues. It has a much better keyboard, still great trackpad, pretty decent specs now, and it's seen a price cut, which means that for, I would say, $1,100, $1,200, similar to what you would get like an XPS 13 for or something, you can get a really well spec'd out MacBook Air. I think the MacBook Air is not only a solid product, but for me, we're starting out with a firm A tier on this one.
Yeah, I mean, it's like clearly the like college student special. Like that will get you through all 4 years of college, no problem. Like it's a really solid laptop. Yeah, I'll give you A tier.
Next up, we have the MacBook Pro, and specifically the 13 inch. This one is weird to me. So previously, the MacBook Pro always had like a major advantage. Like, you know, think like a few years ago, like the MacBook Pro had way more ports, it was significantly more powerful. But now though, the MacBook Pro is, well, yes, it has a little bit more power than the Air. I would argue it's not a huge amount and certainly nothing like the 16 inch. And the problem is, it's expensive.
I don't know who the 13 inch MacBook Pro is for now that the Air is out. I'm gonna say C tier.
I was thinking between C and D, but I'll give you C on that one. It's just, if you want a 13 inch MacBook, if you want more performance in the Air, you should pick the next product, which is the MacBook Pro 16 inch. So as someone who does own a 16 inch MacBook Pro, it is an excellent choice for a still fairly thin but powerful workstation. So compared to the older 15 inch, you get a bigger screen and the same size chassis. It's slightly thicker, which means that not only were they able to fit a bigger battery, but you have the full 8-core processor, you have the upgraded graphics, and on top of all of that, you're getting what I think is probably the sort of best trade-off between performance and battery life in a laptop that you can get right now. Honestly, it's expensive, but if you're a person who needs a 16-inch MacBook Pro, you know that you're a person who needs a 16-inch MacBook Pro.
I'll agree with you on all of that, but the thing that I like can't really overlook with that is just how expensive they make these upgrades. When you're talking like thousands of dollars to jump up with SSDs, and if we're talking like a buy list, I'm giving it a B. If I look to buy a Windows laptop, I'm expecting it to last me like maybe like 2 years. If I'm buying a Mac laptop, I'm expecting it to last maybe 3, 4, 5 years. I mean, I've been using the 2018 i9 MacBook 15 inch, and I have no plans to upgrade that anytime soon. The problem with that is my hard drive's filling up. My RAM is looking a little dated right now. So because everything is soldered down, knowing that this is gonna be, you know, kind of outdated a little bit, and that's where I'm gonna give it the B. Because again, you can't change any components, and it's so expensive to try and future-proof this for yourself. For that $3,000 bump or whatever for the SSD, you might as well just go buy another laptop at that point.
I will agree, B tier for the 16-inch MacBook Pro.
So the regular iMac, not the iMac Pro. This, I mean, how do you want to tackle this one? Because there's the 24-inch and there's the 27-inch.
No, it's 21-inch.
Oh, that's right, the 21-inch and 27-inch. They feel like two completely different computers to me. If you were gonna look at the 27-inch, honestly, I would say A tier.
What? Wait, really? Dude, hold on.
I had the 27-inch iMac for years. And the only reason I stopped using it is because my dog broke the screen when he threw a toy at it.
Nibbler.
It's a gorgeous screen. It was plenty powerful, everything that I needed to do for it. I mean, I wasn't doing super high-end stuff, but I was video editing. And then you look down at like the 21-inch, and the CPU was pretty bad. The GPU is even worse. I mean, it is a mobile GPU in both of them. If we're looking at iMac as a whole, I think the 21-inch drags it down really significantly, and I'm actually gonna say it's C tier.
I will agree. iMac as of today in mid-2020, C tier. Speaking of the iMac Pro. This is a weird one. So, full disclosure, we have a couple of iMac Pros as edit stations here at the office. However, we've had these iMac Pros for 2.5 years now. And the problem is that the iMac Pro really hasn't seen an upgrade since then, right? It's still using those same older Xeon processors. It's still using the Vega graphics. And to be completely fair, there aren't massive upgrades short of going to something like Threadripper. But the iMac Pro was pretty much just brought out as sort of like a stopgap between the standard iMac and the Mac Pro. And then it almost feels like it's been abandoned.
Yeah, because again, I don't know who it's for. So, I mean, it starts at $5,000. So right away, it's out of reach for most enthusiasts. But then if you do have that kind of money, chances are you can probably afford to jump up and get the Mac Pro.
I really struggle to recommend a computer that is 2+ years old with zero updates. I feel like it's D tier.
Yeah, I completely agree.
Well, speaking of the Mac Pro, let's talk about the brand new late 2019 Mac Pro, because this thing is ridiculous. So when it comes to the current Mac Pro, this is a ridiculous system. It starts at $6,000.
That's not counting the wheels. The wheels are a little ridiculous.
There's so much to like about the Mac Pro. And if you're the right person, that's great. But I think the right person is MKBHD and all of Hollywood. Besides that, I don't really think they're selling a lot of these Mac Pros.
It's not meant for the everyday user. And a lot of people don't get that.
I'm not gonna hate on the ability for Apple to sell a very expensive computer. Just like with the RAM from the MacBook Pro, I don't think there's any problem with selling something that's super expensive. I'm not gonna buy one. You're probably not gonna buy one.
I paid $5,000 for the Mac Pro that we upgraded back in like 2011. But again, now here we are 8 years later, and that computer, we were running that and we upgraded it, and it ran just as well as that iMac Pro, according to Jimmy. I'm gonna give it a B.
I will 100% agree. I think it's a very niche product, but the Mac Pro deserves B tier for me. It's funny, we have so many Macs on this list. However, we're missing one, which is the little baby Mac Mini. I'll be real, I like the Mac Mini. It's a weird computer because obviously it's a desktop. It does not support any dedicated graphics, so you're still getting sort of low-end sort of desktop components of like a quad-core or a six-core processor. A little out of date. At this point, it's probably, what, a year and a half old, maybe closer to 2 years.
I love this thing. You know, we used it as an editing PC for a while. You know, just hooking up an eGPU to it.
Yeah, and essentially our setup with the Mac Mini is a Core i7 with 32 gigs of RAM, and then we plug into an external graphics card through Thunderbolt, and then we actually get sort of similar performance to something like a iMac, or even a little bit similar to what you would get on like an iMac Pro in some cases on the lower end, but for a significantly cheaper price. I would like to see an upgrade, but I feel pretty confident calling the Mac Mini C tier.
C tier? I would have given it a B.
It needs an update and it does run a little warm, but the fact that it has like 10 gig Ethernet as an option is really killer in such a tiny little PC. So I'll say C.
I personally would have gone B, but I see where you're coming from with the update.
Matt, what are your thoughts on the Pro Display XDR?
I mean, it's the same thought I have on the Mac Pro. You know, it's not meant for you, because if you're in Hollywood, you're probably using a much better color, you know, accurate display.
The thing I don't like about the Pro Display XDR is that it's very expensive. And while it's good, for most people, I don't think it makes sense. Because you're right, if you're on the crazy high end of production, you're probably looking at something like some like Sony reference monitor, which is probably going to make a little bit more sense. And if you are not on that crazy high end, I personally really like something, especially inside the Apple ecosystem, like the LG UltraFine 5K, which is 1/5 the price, and it's still an excellent panel, 5K resolution. That's what I've been dailying for years.
I agree. The Apple Magic Mouse.
Boo, F tier, F.
Yeah, I'm gonna say the same thing for the trackpad.
Magic Mouse, of course, F. Trackpad, I don't think deserves F. I think the trackpad actually is obviously the best trackpad Apple makes sort of in the business. And the fact that you can use it with like an iPad or with like a Mac or something, I'm okay with trackpad. I'd be willing to give that like B, C, something like that.
B or C, I was gonna give it an F.
Why, what's wrong with the trackpad?
I hate having a trackpad on a desktop.
Yeah, but some people like trackpads.
Fine, you like it, you wanna give it, I'm giving you a C.
C, okay, Magic Trackpad gets a C. The iPad Pro is excellent.
S tier.
Wow, you're S tier already? I wasn't even.
Yeah.
Why is it S tier? Because I would argue it's closer to A tier.
It is easily one of my favorite devices that I've ever owned, period. You know, I do a lot of drawing with it. You know, it's replaced my drawing tablet. In fact, the only reason I'm not using it right now for this video is because when we went to go speed, my iPad was dead because I forgot to charge it.
I mean, to be fair, my Surface was dead, so I had to plug it in while I'm recording too.
I use it so often for most of what I do.
Yeah, so for me, I have actually switched over to the iPad Pro as my main computer. I still do use the Surface sort of alongside it for some things, but generally speaking, the iPad Pro is what lives with me all day long. It's what I do pretty much everything on. I would say this is a bordering S for me. I really love the iPad Pro.
I'm sticking with S. I'm sticking with S, man.
Okay. I think a lot of people are gonna disagree with us, but the iPad Pro, S tier. Alongside the iPad Pro, Magic Keyboard, it's a bit of a weird one. So if we take price out of the equation, Magic Keyboard, A++, S tier, killer, great. It's nicely weighted. It has that very cool floating iPad look. You have a good keyboard as well as excellent trackpad, which is, to be fair, a little bit small. It completely transforms the iPad. The only complaint I have, short of I wish it had a little bit more of a tilt angle, is the fact that it is $300 or $350 if you're buying the 12.9 inch, which to me is ludicrous for a keyboard for a tablet.
I 100% agree. I personally decided not to get one, mainly because of the price. But, you know, again, with me doing all the drawing that I do, the fact that it can't tilt back more than like, you know, 45 degree angle, whatever.
C,
yeah.
Speaking of accessories, this is actually something I feel like you're gonna be much more knowledgeable about than me, is the Apple Pencil.
I'm gonna give this one an A. I struggle to even use my iPad without it. Now, to be fair, I don't, like I said, I don't use the Magic Trackpad, so I haven't like had the same experience as you. But I mean, for drawing, it is wonderful. Especially now with Catalina having Sidecar. You can turn your iPad into a drawing tablet for something like Photoshop and whatnot. And that pen, the pencil has been completely invaluable to me for making like our thumbnails. You know, being able to do those fine details with using that is super helpful. I'm going with A.
Okay, I'll go with that. Next up, we have the iPad Air. This is F tier for me for one very simple reason. It's old and the base iPad exists. We need an update for this thing. It feels out of date. It feels way too expensive.
I wouldn't be surprised if it just goes away completely.
I think there's room for a mid-range iPad, but right now that doesn't exist because there is the base model iPad. Matt, I have obviously been sort of very much on the iPad bandwagon lately, but the base iPad is the one to get. Technically, this is a $330 iPad. However, it is often on sale for as low as $250. And for that, you're getting what is honestly a real laptop style device. Like, obviously, if you want to use it as an iPad, great, and most people do that. But you do have the ability to do more with this if you spend a little bit more money on something like the keyboard. I'm gonna just go straight out and say it. I think the base model iPad is S tier. And in fact, if there was an SS tier, I would put it there. I love that base iPad, even though it might not have the most powerful specs.
I won't argue with that at all. I completely agree. If this had existed when I went and looked and got the iPad Pro, I probably would have gotten this over the iPad Pro just to save the money.
Well, that leaves us with the iPad Mini, which is a weird one because this was kind of dead for a while. Like, it wasn't updated for years and years. And it was updated, I believe, last year with a upgraded processor and I believe Apple Pencil support. The thing with the iPad Mini is I used to love the iPad Mini, right? That was like my first real iPad way back in like 2012, 2013, but to me, phones have gotten so big and stuff like the base iPad exists, which is cheaper. I struggle to place this one. I don't know. Where do you think it lands?
Honestly, I'm just gonna give it, I wanna say like a C or a D.
I would lean toward D. Next, we have AirPods Pro. Matt, are you wearing AirPods Pro right now?
These are my favorite headphones, period. Like, hands down. Now, I don't think they're particularly great sounding, but the convenience of them is through the roof for me. Me personally, S tier, but I get why they wouldn't be S tier for a lot of people.
I'm in total agreement there. I think AirPods Pro are, while they're not amazing sounding, they sound decent, but importantly, they have excellent integration with all of your Apple devices. Sort of moving between is sort of second to none, besides maybe some of the Sony stuff. And they also have what I would consider to be good active noise cancellation for a fully wireless headphone. I totally agree, A tier on that.
So then we have the regular AirPods. So there's one feature on here I love way more than the AirPod Pros, and that's the ability to hang up a call. I would give these a B.
I'll agree. I think that most people would be better served spending that little bit of extra money to get the AirPods Pro with the wireless charging case and everything. But the standard AirPods 2 are decent, especially when you get them on sale, so B tier. Now we get into a tricky sort of place, because now we have the iPhone 11, and we can sort of lump in the iPhone 11 Pro as well. So these are phones which are very, very good, but these are phones which I am almost like allergic to recommending right now, simply because we're filming this in June of 2020. We know pretty much for a fact that there are iPhone 12s with an all new design with 5G that are just a few months away. So while I like the iPhone 11 and really recommended it when it first came out, and I still use an iPhone 11 Pro on a pretty regular basis, if you're trying to buy an iPhone today, that is crazy town.
I agree. Like, if this was a list strictly on like how, you know, ranking the products in a vacuum without the new phone coming along, I love the iPhone 11. It's been great for me, but no one should get this right now. You should wait a couple months, get the next model.
My thought is, if you're going to buy one of these phones, I would recommend the iPhone 11. So I would say maybe the iPhone 11 gets D tier. No, you know, I think they both need D tier, because it's so tough to recommend.
It's very hard to recommend these.
You know, it's not hard to recommend the iPhone SE. So this is a brand new device in some ways, and yet it's a very old device in others. So it has the iPhone 8 design, which is the same as the iPhone 7, which is similar to the iPhone 6S, which is based on the iPhone 6. So obviously very dated bezels, you've got Touch ID, but on the flip side, for $400, you get these same specs as that iPhone 11 or iPhone 11 Pro. You get a upgraded camera, which is not too far off, not quite as good, but still pretty impressive. And you get the wireless charging, the water resistance. You get a lot of those high-end features for a budget phone from this company called Apple, which I think is revolutionary. I really, really like the iPhone SE.
I mean, the chip, like the processor in it, is literally the most powerful you can get right now for $400.
A tier?
I would have said B, but I'll give you A.
Okay, I think that's fair. A tier to me feels right for the iPhone SE. So next up, we have a product, Matt, which I sometimes forget Apple still sells, which is the very last of the iPods, the iPod Touch.
No one should buy an iPod Touch because it's only for a kid. You know, like someone who's not quite ready to have a phone. But let's face it, if you have a kid, you have your old iPhone. Give them that, take a SIM card out of it, don't buy the iPod.
Or even better, if you don't have an older iPhone, you can really easily pick up slightly older model iPhones, either refurbished, or you can get them on like some like no contract carrier, and boom, you've got yourself something which is as good, if not better than that iPod, has phone capabilities if you want them, and is likely going to be cheaper. I agree, F tier. Unless they really rethink the iPod Touch, I don't think it needs to exist anymore.
So we all use Apple Watches here. This is the only smartwatch that I ever really liked. I'm inclined to give Apple Watch A tier.
I really like the Apple Watch. I've liked the Apple Watch since day one. I think Apple's done a very good job of recognizing that there's a market for a wearable which has all of this functionality and continuing to make it better and better and better and better, right? Like they had like a good starting place with some clear flaws, and every year they make the battery better, they give it LTE, they give it Wi-Fi, they allow it to work better by itself. You get maybe not necessarily better app support, but even the ability to have the always on display, which to be fair is still kind of kills your battery, but they've done a very good job of consistently adding really good features. I would say this is a very clear A tier. Next up we have the Apple HomePod. Unless your name is Ken Bolito, I don't see much reason to buy a HomePod. My main issue is it sounds great, but it's incredibly expensive. And even though it's seen some price cuts, I don't really love Siri, and I certainly don't love the idea of at $200, $250 spending that much for the HomePod.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I got the IKEA, Sonos lamp that looks exactly like a HomePod, but it has a lamp on it. It sounds great. It does all the functionality. It's way cheaper.
The Apple TV 4K is an interesting device. I really like the way that sort of the Apple TV seamlessly, especially if you have something like an LG OLED, it seamlessly transitions in and out of HDR modes. It is sort of a very cohesive experience. For me, I think it's a pretty firm B tier. It's probably in need of an update with some newer specs at some points. It's getting a little bit old.
I haven't used one mainly because now they offer the Apple TV app with like something like Roku. Like I said, I haven't really used one, so I'll give you the B.
Okay, yeah, that's a very good point. Yeah.
Now we get into their services. So first we have Apple TV Plus, which we had done a video on where I claimed that it already failed. And you know what? I'm sticking by that claim. I don't think anyone really is talking about how great Apple TV Plus is. You know, one, I don't think anyone's actually paying for it because everyone got it free when they bought an iPhone.
Dude, it's too competitive, right? We have Disney Plus. We have obviously Netflix being a juggernaut. Apple TV Plus, man, I cannot sign up for that as is. I feel like there's probably improvements coming. I feel like they will likely have some kind of bundle that's rumored to have sort of Apple TV Plus included with like news and like arcade and all this kind of stuff and Apple Music, which we could talk about in a second. I think it's D tier. I think it has some potential, but man, Apple TV Plus, it's D tier when it's free.
I would give it D if it wasn't currently free. Lastly, we have Apple Music.
Yeah, look, there's nothing wrong with Apple Music, right? I mean, you have similar sort of libraries, but the thing is for me, as far as I'm concerned, I'm very happy with Spotify. C tier for Apple Music. There's nothing wrong with it, but I don't see a lot of reason to actually pay for that service over something else.
I agree. I completely agree with you on that.
With that, we have our final Apple tier list. So take a look at this and let us know in the comments. Do you agree with our tier list? Are we wild idiots for putting two iPads on top of every Apple product that they make? Let us know in the comments below. Make sure to subscribe. And until next time, Matt, what mistake are we going to make next time?
I think people wanted a PlayStation tier list.
I mean, PS5 F tier, obviously. Hashtag Xbox fanboy.